Mommy's curls always remind me of the girl from Catherine, that video game. Yeah. The kind of, what are they? The kind of like cues. Curly fry hair.
This week on A Backward Compatible, in this annual Halloween Spooktacular, Chris and Doc are joined by Cara Curley to discuss costume and character design. Plus, scary long editions of the Button Mosh and Mobile Minute. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. Welcome to episode number 113, lucky number 13, of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, our Halloween Spooktacular. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Doc.
Hey, hey.
And returning guest is with us today, Cara Curley.
Hey there.
Ah, where'd you come from?
Poof.
Just appeared, vanished.
She might be a witch.
Well, that's why it's the Halloween special.
Yeah, exactly. Actually, no, it wouldn't be vanished. It would have been, like, apparated or something, perhaps.
Well, I mean, I do have a black cat, so it would make sense that I'm a witch.
Oh, there you go. But today's meaty topic, we've done a few different Halloween-related or Halloween-themed topics before for the Spooktacular, including scary games and designing scary games. So we want to do something other than scary stuff because it's a little bit played out. Halloween costumes. We're going to talk about costume design. And I'm sure that there's going to be a little bit of sort of character design that comes up as part of that as well. So it should be an interesting talk. But first, we have a few opening segments for you, including a scary long button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
All right, so I've got a couple of games I'm going to talk about today, and I will save the better for later. I'm going to start off with Fire Emblem Warriors. It is in the same franchise as the Dynasty Warrior series. It's one of their spin-offs. And this is the second one that they've teamed up with Nintendo for. So a little while back on the Wii U, they had Hyrule Warriors, and that was based on The Legend of Zelda. I played it and enjoyed it for the most part. It's a funny thing, and I think I talked about this at the time when I first started playing that. You learn very quickly that Dynasty Warriors isn't just a beat-em-up game. It's more about prioritizing different objectives and moving around the map and trying to cut off attacks, take objectives, that sort of thing. It's all about being as efficient as you can with your fighting because you're trying to sort of race against the enemy force trying to do what they're trying to do. And it's, in a way, kind of mindless. and so that's one of the biggest complaints about it, is it's just kind of like this ridiculous over-the-top action that doesn't really have much depth to it, aside from that strategic element, like I mentioned. But I find that it's a really great game for just sort of turning your brain off for a while and just kind of hacking and slashing. And actually, Fire Emblem Warriors does some really interesting things with the series. One of my biggest complaints about Hyrule Warriors was how you spend a lot of time running back and forth across the map to get to your different objectives. And you also had this thing where your ally characters were constantly just inept and competent. So you'd be in the middle of trying to take an objective, and then it's like, oh no, someone is dangerously low on health. Let me run all the way across the map to save their butt because they can't fight for some reason. And then you have to run back and take the thing you're trying to take. So what Fire Emblem does that's really cool is it borrows, and the Zelda tried to do this in its own way, but I don't think it was as effective, borrowing elements from the One franchise to build into Dynasty or into the Warrior series. Fire Emblem's take on it is you can actually control multiple units, you can switch between them, and you can give orders to them as you're fighting, which is in the spirit of Fire Emblem because it's a tactical role-playing game. So as an example, I've got four characters on the field, and they actually do take into account the weapon triangle. So kind of the rock, paper, scissors style, sword beats axe, axe beats lance, and so on, where it's optimal to send a character with a weapon advantage to take out a character with a weapon disadvantage. And so I can look at the map and say, okay, this fort is being guarded by someone with an axe. I'm going to send one of my sword users over there to try to take that fort. And they're actually competent. They'll take longer than a player would, but you can actually count on them eventually taking that fort most of the time.
Oh, that's cool.
So I can send my characters off to different corners of the map to do different things, and then I'll sort of take on the most challenging thing, or the thing that needs to be done the fastest, or whatever the case might be. And then if there's some priority problem across the map, if you're smart about the way you position your units, you can switch to someone who's close enough by that it only takes you like just a few seconds to run over to the problem that you're trying to address, rather than having to run all the way across the map like you usually do.
Oh, that's nice too.
So I'm actually pretty impressed with the game. It's again kind of mindless. The action is kind of generic. It's sort of comical almost in its over the topness. You're just mowing through thousands and thousands of enemies. I've been playing on hard mode actually, which I'm not sure if it's the hardest difficulty. It's the hardest one you start with at the very
There's
least.
There's something harder than hard.
I'm not sure. It doesn't seem that way, but you never know, I suppose.
It's because you're so MLG, Chris.
Yeah. And also, I've had enough experience with the series that normal was just too easy. The only complaint that I have with hard is that they sort of artificially just extend the health bar of bosses. So you just get bored halfway through a boss fight because it's like, okay, I get it.
Just keep hitting.
Yeah, just keep hitting them. And then the other slight problem, it's cool and uncool at the same time. They have a leveling system in this one, which isn't something you typically have. You've always had the ability to kind of enhance your characters with more moves or special abilities, but never really a straight up RPG stats rising sort of thing.
Yeah.
But because it's Fire Emblem, they wanted to fold that in. So you'll be leveling up your characters as you're going through fights, and you'll sometimes find that there's a boss that takes even longer to kill because they're a higher level than you're optimized for.
Oh, that makes sense.
So I had to replay the same mission a couple times because there's a time limit, and it just took me so long to kill the bosses.
Well, as we all know,
Chris, from our over-leveling, under-leveling episode, you under-level.
Yeah, I do.
So for me, I'd go in and I'd just kill it. And then I'd be bored the other way.
Yeah, right.
Because I overlevel.
So, I'm liking it overall. It's got some pretty good depth. I'm interested to get further into it to see. Eventually, I know you can class up, so you can turn your classes into advanced classes, just like you can in Fire Emblem. So I'm sure that's going to add more weapons and fighting styles and that sort of thing. So, so far, it's really cool. I'd recommend it if you've ever been interested in the Warrior series. And if you're interested in Warriors, this is probably about as good a starting point as you can find because of that extra depth. And I really think the strategic thing is something they need to keep for the entire series because it is so much better.
I like this trend. I think it's cool to see some of these games that are getting mashups. We've talked about Puyo Puyo Tetris, and that's completely different from, say, the Warhammer Total War. Would be an example I'd throw out there. Those two are so completely unlike anything, but to take the property of one thing and insert it into the other for the gameplay sake, I like it. I like where it's going with that. And all I can say is if Fallout 4 had that thing where you could switch to another character, oh man. But most of the time it was like, oh, look, your settlement is under attack. Oh, well, sorry guys, I'm on a different island.
Yeah.
You know, I'm doing DLC stuff. Sorry.
Bye.
So, Cara, have you been playing anything interesting?
Well, okay, so this is several years late, but I got a decent chunk of free time recently, and I had heard that Red Dead Redemption was an awesome game just throughout the years.
Yeah, people are saying that.
I do believe I have heard the kids say on the street.
Those kids are graduated from college now.
Those kids are graduated from college. And I have had Red Dead Redemption that I think I just acquired from someone was moving. And they're like, we don't even have an Xbox 360. So just take it. Awesome. Red Dead Redemption. And I had initially started it back in 2013 in the middle of college. And classes happened.
I know how that goes.
But I got past the tutorial section and got an hour or two further into the game and then just stopped, and then 4 years later re-picked it up. But I was already too invested into the game that I didn't want to go back to the start. So I was just like, I can handle this. I know how to video game. Spoiler alert, I didn't know how to video game.
I can already tell the story's not true because you said 4 years for college. Who does that?
Well, no, this is 4 years after I initially picked it up. So it was sophomore year. So sophomore year of college. And then now I'm 2 years out of college.
My mistake.
And I was like, okay, awesome sauce. time to do the video game, and it just went very poorly. Like, things that would be common sense, like you have a horse and you can whistle for it,
right,
didn't actually happen for me until I think hour 12 into the game. I figured out that, oh, you do have your own, because I think someone mentioned, like, oh, your horse, and I went, well, I don't actually know what my horse looks like because it keeps changing. And they're like, what do you mean it keeps changing? I'm like, well, I just keep looking for the hitching posts where I put my horse last, and the texture changes, but I just take it. And I realized I was actually stealing other people's horses the whole time.
Grand Theft Horse.
Grand
Theft Equine.
Equine.
Well, nice. Fine.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And other things, like, they actually have an auto-aim system in Red Dead Redemption.
Correct.
Which, that took me until about hour 10. Before then, it was just me, like, wiggling the camera and screaming and wondering why I kept dying and mm-hmm. how anyone could possibly play this game.
Well, you can turn it off, so...
Yes, but as soon as I figured out there was auto aim, and I was actually competing with the auto aim because I would accidentally pull the right trigger and then wiggle the camera afterwards. So I was actually double screwing myself with this. It was a bad experience.
And curve the bullets.
And then, as soon as I realized all of that, I was just making it harder for myself. The world opened up, and it was like one of the most fun games I have ever experienced. The atmospheres were great. It was really depressing. Like, no one in that game is redeemable. All the NPCs
That's
are
so
just
true.
Awful. And it just felt like a punch in the face, but it was the most beautiful punch in the face I have ever experienced.
Mm-hmm.
But I made it a lot harder for myself than it probably should have been.
Did you beat it?
I did. Well, I intentionally stalled because I knew how it was going to end.
Right.
And, I'm just going to say it because people should have played it years ago.
Spoiler alert.
Spoiler alert.
We spoiled it on the podcast before anyway. So.
Yeah, okay. So then you end up playing as Jack. And finally, because I'm almost at 100%, and then I stopped at like 98.5 just because my freelance clients came back. I'm like, okay, now I actually have to get back to work. But if I want to get these outfits, I have to play as Jack. And the most disappointing moment for me was... the barn scene when all the FBI agents come to kill John, it automatically throws you into Deadeye.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I was going to be clever and Deadeye it without knowing it was already going to do it. So I undid the Deadeye and got shot.
Right.
And that's when I just like threw my controller and walked around. I'm just like, well, this is just another layer of my own incompetence that just ruined it for me. And, now I'm playing as Jack, and I'm trying to get the U.S. Army uniform and whatever. Yep. But
you can't not die. It's sad.
Yeah, I know. But so that was my experience with a game that I should have played a zillion years ago. But now I don't have to face the, you know, the long waiting time that mm-hmm. everyone's waiting for too. Although I might, because I don't actually have an Xbox One. I am clinging onto my Xbox 360, and they can take it from my cold dead hands.
Well, you can just skip that one and go straight into the Bone X or whatever it's being called now.
A very cool game that maybe you missed, maybe you didn't. It is called Death Squared, and it is pretty much only on the Switch. But the amazing thing about it is it falls right into what we've talked about before with the whole death of, pun intended, couch co-op.
Mm.
This is a total full-on couch co-op game that involves lots of exploding robots.
Nice.
If I had to give it a tone comparison, I would actually say that it fits really, really well into the Portal world, but there aren't really any portals. There's a few teleporters, but that it's not the same thing. It's as if you were playing in the Portal world as the robots, okay? But what it's about is you've got this very small little space, and you need to get from point A to point B. And in order to do this, you have to work together, which means you've got to hit buttons. The buttons make little like platforms raise or walls go down or terrible lasers come on and off, that kind of a thing. You see where I'm going with all this?
Mm-hmm.
So your robots are going to die over and over and over again. And you are going to laugh and you are going to scream and you are going to have so much fun together trying to get through this level because it is all about the cooperation. Now, I have yet to play with three other people, so to do the full four-player thing. But I played with two players and loved it. My brother-in-law and I, last time he was in town, oh man, we just rocked this game. We got through like 30 levels in an afternoon. It was so much fun. And when you do that, what you do is you kind of toggle between two different robots. And they're basic colors. It's like a green and a blue and a yellow and a red one. And so what you do is you control two of them, and then the other person controls two of them. I actually think that's a really nice sweet spot, because then you get more than just, okay, my robot found his button, and now I sit while everyone else figures it out, unless they die. But now you're like, okay, I'll switch over to red, and now I'll keep doing the thing, and we'll strategize some more. And, oh, wait, no, that's you. You need to do the thing first. And it's just this great back and forth, give and take. And it really, really reminded me of the Portal universe, especially the multiplayer stuff in Portal 2, if you remember that.
Yeah.
That's the feel that it had. Anyway, what's cool about it is it's super cheap. It's only $15. If you've got a Switch, I absolutely recommend it. If you've got any kind of a party game mentality that you like, because that's how I would classify it, give it a try. On Nintendo.com, they say it is a puzzle game about cooperation, best enjoyed with friends, and I will confirm that. I tried a level or two by myself, and you can do it. Mm-hmm. You can switch between all of them. Kind of like the snipper clips.
Snipper clips,
yeah, about to say, you can do that by yourself. It's boring.
Yeah.
The fun of it is the interaction with people, right? So it says it's a puzzle game about cooperation, communication, and robot explosions. Yeah, that's absolutely what it is. So phenomenal fun. I highly, highly recommend Death Squared.
And speaking of the Switch, the other game that I've been playing recently is Super Mario Odyssey.
Aha, you got it.
I did.
Yep. Okay.
And this is actually just a few days old at this point. So I haven't gotten super far into the game, but what I have played has been really fantastic.
Really?
Yeah, it's a really excellent game.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that.
And so it's moving back, and this is something that anyone's sort of been following the game since the announcement will probably know, but it's kind of going back into the kind of sub-series of Mario 64, Super Mario Galaxy, Sunshine, all those, as opposed to, like, you know, say, like 3D World, 3D Land, all those.
Right.
And then, of course, there's the new Super Mario series, which is the 2D side-scrolling stuff.
Mm-hmm. Classic.
So what's interesting is that aesthetically and in terms of some of the level design, it does remind me a bit here and there of like 3D World. Sometimes they give you sort of like these very sort of blocky floating stages. But also you have some of the more open, like kind of big landscapes that you might have had in something like, say, Mario 64.
Mm-hmm.
The big new mechanic that you have in this one is you have this companion called Cappy. Basically, your hat gets destroyed and he becomes your new hat. And so
he's a parasitic alien, right? Brain sucker?
Something like that.
Yeah,
yes.
Okay.
That hasn't happened yet. I'm sure like some point, like the turning point of the story is going to be, it turns out he's actually leeching off of you.
You have to beat him. You have to fight him in the end.
Yeah. but it basically, his being there changes up your moveset somewhat. So if you're familiar with the other games in the sub-series, like things like the long jump, the backflip, that sort of thing, all stays the same, but your punches and kicks and stuff like that are now replaced with throwing your cap. And you can actually use some of your motion controls on the Switch to have a little bit more control over the way the cap is flying.
Hmm.
There's actually a two-player co-op mode where the second player can also control the cap. So whereas when you're playing as Mario, you can just sort of like throw your cap a certain distance. Maybe you can home in on an enemy or an item or something like that. With two players, once you throw the cap, they can sort of take over and fly in any direction they want. They can go further than usual. You can team up to like get yourself an extra high jump or an extra long jump, that sort of thing. So I'm actually kind of curious to see what speedrunners do once they start getting into like two-player shenanigans, what you're able to sort of unlock with that. But in terms of the design, it's really, really, really well done. Basically, what they do is instead of the traditional thing where they kind of have you restart the same stage over and over again to get different stars, it's just kind of an open sandbox and you explore it freely. You go around, like you can find like little hidden things. The equivalent of stars in this one is moons. And the moons you can find sometimes just like hidden away someplace, or sometimes they'll sort of point you toward a big one that's kind of the current objective, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But along the way to getting that, you pick up a whole bunch of other ones. And this is important because it powers the ship you use to go from world to world, or kingdom to kingdom, I should say.
Ah.
And generally speaking, I think you spend maybe an hour-ish per kingdom. So you kind of get a chance to fully explore this place, but without sort of overstaying its welcome. They have this really good sense of pace. You get the moons very quickly. So rather, again, instead of starting over each time you get one, you just sort of grab one and keep going, which gives it such a great flow. And it's great rewards for exploration. Apparently, they've actually built in to the game this sort of philosophy that players are going to find ways to break it. And so they'll put these massive rewards.
Because they know they will.
They'll put these big rewards in places they don't expect people to get to. And then someone will post a video of them like using this crazy series of jump off my hat to fly through the air, like, you know, 100 yards or something like that, to land on a rooftop they're not supposed to get to collect all these coins.
Like a giant pile.
Yeah.
Like, because I think someone posted that on Reddit today going like, well, they didn't expect this. So they just.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they forced their own devs to use Mario Maker 3D, which doesn't exist, so that they had to prove it was possible before it went into the game.
Yeah, maybe.
Right? You know what I'm saying?
But I think, though, that
I thought that was funnier than he did.
The impression I get, though, is like from what I've been seeing and reading is that they expect people to do what they don't expect. And so they'll put these rewards in places. They'll put these secrets in places that they don't think it's possible to get to, knowing that someone's going to figure out how to get to it.
Like the soccer ball in Halo, or like, I don't know, there were just other things that they had placed throughout the levels that no one who is actually just focused on getting from objective to objective will actually go out of their way to look for that stuff. Mm-hmm. But people who are really invested will just stumble upon these things.
Yep. Aesthetically, the game is really great. It controls just as well as you'd expect. Overall, I think this is probably a game of the year contender pretty easily. It's definitely lived up to the hype.
So, yeah.
It's been getting great reviews and well-deserved. I don't want to say too much more about it because I've kind of...
How many worlds are there?
That I don't know, but my impression is that there's going to be quite a few because
really?
I feel like I'm still pretty early in the game. I've been through... There's kind of like a tutorial world, and then one where you get your ship, which is pretty short. And then after that, it sort of turns into the Odyssey, the journey, if you will, where your ship is called the Odyssey. It's like this giant flying top hat, kind of.
Interesting.
Lots of hats in this game. And what's kind of cool about it, too, and without getting too sidetracked, they explore some interesting new looks and feels for Mario. And I think this is one of their objectives going into it, is they kind of wanted to have a fresh new take on it.
Mm-hmm.
So New Donk City is kind of the most obvious example of we put Mario in kind of like New York City with people that are just normal humanoid, not, you know, cartoonish mushroom people.
Right.
And so it's just like this clash of aesthetics that still kind of works. I haven't been to that one yet, but I'm looking forward to it. They seem to be taking a lot more kind of like 1920s, 30s themed stuff. There seems to be a bit of a kind of old school Broadway musical aesthetic to a lot
really?
Of it. Yeah.
I did not expect that.
Yeah.
Speaking
so it's
of retro.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah. So yeah, it's kind of an interesting, it totally makes sense with Mario because his look and feel has always been kind of based on that. You know, the Italian plumber from Brooklyn was kind of the original concept.
Hey, it's a me.
Exactly. And so they're kind of exploring that, but yeah, I've been through, after those first few, I think three more, and then there's still more to come. So there's a little bit of branching at one point. You get to sort of choose which of the two worlds you want to go to next, or two kingdoms. And then once you finish one, then you check out the other one and so on. So it's the typical you're chasing after Bowser plot, but now he's got an airship and you're chasing in your own airship and trying to fuel it with the moons that you're collecting. So yeah, I don't want to say too much more about it. Just go play it because it's awesome. If you have a Switch, it's a must-own on Switch. If you like Mario, it might be worth getting a Switch for. So
you can't tell me what to do.
I know I can't, but I can strongly advise.
You're not his real dad.
I know.
It's true.
So another game that I've actually been playing recently, and this isn't just a recent thing for me. This is my recurring favorite game of all time, and it's Orcs Must Die 2.
Oh,
and
is this the guilty pleasures episode?
This one's my personal guilty pleasure.
Excellent.
Dim the lights, light the candles. We're going to talk about Orcs Must Die 2. But and I know Robot, which is actually here in town, came out with Orcs Must Die Unchained, which has gone through several different levels of development, but I found my sweet spot with Orcs Must Die 2, and there's kind of a plot that's I would describe it as shoehorned in. Mm-hmm. The overarching goal is there are orcs and you kill them. You kill them en masse. Mm-hmm. And in the plot rounds, each game lasts about 15 minutes, but there's also kind of like a firefight mode where there's just endless waves of orcs coming at you. And for some reason, which I cannot really fully describe to you why, I have played about 9 days worth of my life of this endless orc killing firefight mode.
That's because something to be proud of.
It's just beautiful. So it's a mix between tower defense and first person shooter.
What's it on? I admit my ignorance.
I think they had it on Xbox 360 or something at one point, but I recommend playing it on PC.
Okay.
So you set up a bunch of traps, tell the orcs, all right, it's great to come out. And then as they're coming out, the traps are killing them as you're shooting them too. And you get bonus points for, I guess, combinations of traps. Like the more traps touch an orc before it dies, mm-hmm. the more points you get.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And at one point, like in my peak, which this was the one game I actually had time to play in college, I was probably, in terms of score, one of the top 1% of orc killers in the world.
Oh, nice.
But it's been a while.
Can I shake your hand?
Yeah, no, exactly. Well, the thing is, that's the only game I've ever actually been good at. So the Red Dead Redemption kind of arc that I had described previously is how I am at most games. I am just terrible at them. But for some reason, my sweet spot is orc killing en masse.
Uh-huh.
I think I've killed over like 600,000 orcs or something ridiculous.
Wow.
But it's been a while. And so I'm like, you know what? I want to go revisit my kind of peak, my childhood or kind of college, I guess, peak. I'm going to play some Orcs Must Die 2. And I was terrible at it. Like, I'm trying to relearn how to, like, okay, if I build these traps on top of these other traps, and like, cause you have to, like, you know, if you blow them up in the air and then have spikes come out, they'll go flying off ridges and cliffs, and you have to get creative
while on fire
Sweet. Or frozen. Like, you have to get creative about, okay, well, I want to herd them into this one area and then grind them into little bits as they're screaming, "Mommy, no, I miss my mom."
And that's like, disturbing.
It is disturbing. And that it's great because all I feel is pain and agony is like stuff you'll be hearing as they're dying and being scorched. And in a very sick, twisted way, that just tickled my fancies. And I'm getting back into that. I'm getting good again at orc killing. And I want to thank Robot Entertainment for making this simple but fun game that just revolves around death and torture all in one with this beautiful cartoonish veneer.
Very appropriate for our spooktacular.
Really?
Yes. Well, no, they are. And so the orcs actually look very Halloween-y. They're green. They have these misshapen features, little tufts of hair at top. And there's like a sorceress who is very witchy looking. Mm-hmm. And it is exactly cartoonish, beautiful models. Mm-hmm. It happens, like, you can kill them in dungeons and caverns. It feels like a Halloween game. And if you guys have the opportunity, I totally recommend going out and playing it.
Cool.
I honestly had no idea what it was. I thought it was like just an app or something.
Like, no. Well,
like Plants vs. Zombies kind of thing, you know?
No, it's definitely more of a PC-based game. And I liked the combination between tower defense and first person shooter because mm-hmm. you feel clever when you're setting up your kind of grand scheme,
mm-hmm.
but you're also directly interacting with it. So you have the adrenaline rush while it's actually
That's
happening.
Super interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I didn't really expect, cause like tower defense in itself is not something that I like the kind of set and forget.
Right.
Because I've always been more of a shooter person.
Yeah, I get bored too with tower defense. So.
And then there's different ways that you can shoot at them too, because they'll give you like either a gun or a magic wand or something, but you also get weapons like a ring where you can just turn things into chickens. Or actually, it'll do a random kind of turn an orc into another different sort of orc, and you can luck out and it'll turn into a chicken, which the orcs will try to kill.
Nice.
Like, there's a lot of weird stuff in this game. It's very humorous. And it's a great Halloween experience, too.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
All right, let's talk about Stranger Things. But don't go away yet.
This is a spoiler-free discussion of Stranger Things, mostly because none of us have seen season two yet. What we're actually talking about is the mobile game, which, oh, I even hate calling it that, because it is, in my opinion, one of the best, let's call it, retro likes that has come out in a very, very long time. As I was playing Stranger Things, the mobile game, I actually felt like I was playing a Super Nintendo game from kind of the exploration era, if you will, the RPG exploration era of that particular console. Took me about 7 hours to play through to 100% completion. It'd probably take you about 4 hours if you just want to just do it. It is, when you start, it, as far as I can tell, picking up basically in between season one and season two with, and it sounds terrible, but this is actually a perfect choice, no story to speak of. It is mostly an exploration game, and you are Hopper, the sheriff, and you're going to go find the kids. That's pretty much it. Now, you do pop into the Upside Down a little bit during parts of it. You, of course, go to the secret base. That's where kind of where you start. And as you explore, you're going to find out there's parts you can't go to. There's a big log in my way. In order to have the log, I need to have the baseball bat so I can smash it. Or, there's a bear over here. In order to do that, I'm going to have to draw him out somehow, right? And so it turns out that each kid has their own special ability. And Hopper's is to just punch stuff, which I think is amazing. He can run and punch. And it's just beautiful. It's just perfect. And it's not overcomplicated. You don't pick up extra stuff. You don't level up. You don't get extra hearts. You don't do any of that stuff, really. But what you do is you get more kids, okay? Now, I'll actually take back what I just said, because you do actually get more hearts in that sense. But in kind of the Zelda sense, you do. But what I mean is you don't level up. That's really what I'm trying to say. Instead, what you end up doing is really spending a number of hours deep in this map, this beautiful, beautiful map of the town of Hawkins, right? And in doing that, if you go back and you do what my wife and I are now doing, which is to watch season one in preparation for season two or to binge it or whatever, you're going to be like, wait, there's a lake behind Hopper's house. I never noticed it before. But he's out there on the back on his little porch, and he overlooks this little tiny – it's not even really a lake. It's just a pond. Mm. That's totally in the game. I'm like, wow, I never realized that was there. As they bike through the woods, they do all the Tolkien references for and whatnot. It's like, oh, well, it's down the road from the main town, which is why he had to bike down. That actually makes a lot of sense. They did so much research. I am absolutely positive that they sat down, binged it themselves. Well, I suppose we could ask them, because here's the cool thing. This was bonus XP. And bonus XP, BXP, is literally down the road from us here in Dallas. We actually know, like, I think everybody mm-hmm. on the team.
Alex Swaim has been on the show before.
Yeah. And, of course, Phil Johnson. Mm-hmm. And so, who I worked with at University of Texas at Dallas, mm-hmm. and now he's out in California. And so the last thing he said to me was, I can't tell you what I've been working on, but you're gonna love it. And I'm like, well, was it this? Was it this? Was it this? Was it this? He's like, no, shut up. Stop.
And we can't tell you.
Right. And so finally, I see that he has, he's tweeted out and Facebooked and done that, you know, that he was like in California. And I'm like, it was Stranger Things, wasn't it? And he's like, yes, you finally got it. And so, and this was after he'd come out and I'd already played it. And I saw his name literally on the thing. So I think he's the second one credited. Mm. So it's so cool to see former students who have been a part of this project and also former colleagues who've been a part of this project. And I got to say, they did an absolutely phenomenal, stellar job. Bobby Fry's art, along with the other artists.
Bobby's also been on.
That was Bobby?
That was Bobby.
Oh, my gosh.
It wasn't just him. I mean, there was, well, there was a team. But, I mean, you know his pixel art.
Yeah.
It's wonderful. And so as soon as I saw it, I'm like, that's totally Bobby.
Yeah.
And so it's really cool to have this thing that you really – because I'm a huge Stranger Things fan. Mm-hmm. Huge fan. And when I heard there was 9 episodes instead of 8, I did a little dance because I'm like, there's an extra hour in season 2. Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the level I'm at. And to know that these guys dug in that deep and did a service to it, it is clearly not, hey, we got a job, let's go do a thing. Mm-hmm. There is so much love poured into that project mm-hmm. that if you're not aware of it or you were aware of it but you didn't take the time, immediately go download Stranger Things and play it. It is one of the best games I have played in years and years and years.
Is it free to play? Or?
It is totally
because
free
basically
to play.
Just an advertisement for the show.
Okay. So. Yeah.
No, it is not just an advertisement
well,
for the
show.
It's
that.
More than
it
that.
It is more than that.
Monetization-wise, that's what it's trying to go for.
Netflix completely got what its function was, and that is, hey, guys, we're going to throw you this thing and get you excited about the show as it comes out. Mm-hmm. I think they've done their advertising very, very well for that. And also, it's a little late now, but if you did play it, you do have access to a trailer before anybody else did. And so I actually got to see that the final trailer before it was released, about 3 or 4 days before it was released, and that was exciting. So, but yeah, anyway, you can grab it on just about any system, phone system, I mean, and download it. It'll take you about 4 to 7 hours, depending on if you want to 100% the thing. And there's so many little Easter eggs. It's so much fun. Like, you go out into the forest, you're going to get attacked by an owl. Well, there's a reference in the show. I mean, you may not even remember it because it's so random about, Hop says, the most exciting thing that happens in this town was last week so-and-so got attacked by an owl. That was it. Right. But then you go in and you're like, you go through the files and you're like, wow, all of these are files about owl attacks.
Oh my gosh. And it's like, so they did really just, they probably just marathoned it. We're like, okay, guys.
They had to. The granularity with which they did that was the same level of love of, I would say, like Mystery Science Theater 3000 with their 600 jokes per episode. Mm-hmm. That's the level of love that went into making this project. It was very, very well done. Well, and I'm not surprised because I know these guys. They are awesome.
Hope other content creators are able to recognize that and then kind of bring them on to more projects.
Yes. Well, and I'll just say this as a general kind of a thing. In a time whenever we gamers have become so cynical that we're like, you know, what's the Mordor, the
Shadow
of War, right? Just came out. Yeah. Well, Shadow of Mordor was the first one.
Yeah.
Shadow of War just came out and people are like, yeah, it's a good game, but microtransactions, blah, rah, rah. Mm-hmm. We hate them. Oh, you suck. All of you guys. La, 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 la. Yeah, exactly. And it's like, I'm so tired of that kind of anger and just hate. And then you get this thing that comes along and it's, hey guys, we love this. You love this. It's free. Go. Paid for by your Netflix subscription.
And I haven't finished the game yet, but I played through the first level in that sort of underground base. Sort of
fun, right?
And yeah, I mean, it was really well designed. They did a great job with like kind of teaching you through the gameplay and all this different stuff. So really just nailed it with the execution. It's a really great game.
Mm-hmm. I had one moment down there where I was like, uh-oh, I don't know what to do next. And then I thought it through and realized, oh, clever puzzle. Mm-hmm. Okay, got it. And moved on. And it was in that first level, and it was during that learning time. Mm-hmm. But
So I have been getting into Clash Royale lately, and I've actually played it since it came out. But they've introduced some new gaming modes and introduced something called Quests. So I've actually been playing more. And I appreciate this game, another game that I'm actually fairly... I'm middle of the pack on this one. I'm not horrible, but I'm not one of the great players either. And I'm one of the terrible mobile gamers who refuses to spend money on Clash Royale. But I'm really enjoying it. It's a very fast-paced kind of tower defense game. And you slap down different characters with different abilities who march forward and try to destroy your opponent's towers as their characters are marching forward and trying to destroy your towers. And it's you basically have seconds to throw down different characters as you have like energy bars called elixir. And certain cards or characters cost different amounts of elixir. So you're trying to strategize and run against your timer. You know, what cards can I play that will counter my opponent's cards while also trying to get me past their dudes to kill their towers. And there's just so much going on that it gives me that adrenaline rush that I need in my otherwise fairly mundane, boring day. And just because there's so many different levels of actually what's going on, you're trying to defend, you're trying to attack, and you're trying to counter. And I think they did a really, Supercell is the one who made it, and they did a really great job with their design of just how their characters look and feel and are animated throughout the screen, because you only have a split second to react and try to gauge, okay, if I have this amount of elixir, what can I play? And did I actually play the right card? Because often I'll drag the wrong one out there. And you have to be able to tell at a glance, you know, what the abilities coming at you are and what you can counter with. And it's been kind of fun. They've been, they introduced a new game mode a couple weeks ago called Touchdown, where there are no towers, but you're just trying to get from point A to point B on your opponent's field. And you're playing with another player, actually, who you can't talk to. And so you're trying to indicate, okay, if I'm trying to weasel this character through their defenses, which are other characters, you got to try to do a thing that can complement my moves. And it's been this really odd experience in communication. Just trying to go, okay, trying to read your opponent and fellow player's mind, which has been a fun exploration for me, because that's not something I usually think about.
Interesting.
So
yeah, I played a little bit of Clash Royale a little while back, and I enjoyed it well enough, but mainly I was playing it because a lot of people in my office were playing it, and when they stopped talking about it as much, I kind of just let it slide. But it sounds like there might be some features worth checking out again. So
yeah, and I actually don't know very, I wish more friends of mine played it, because they said you can play with friends, although I feel like I wander into kind of risky territory whenever I do cooperative playing, because I don't want to lose friendships. And some people with mobile games especially can get very competitive. Like,
I never heard that.
Really? And or like, I knew people who were really into Clash of Clans and just had these amazing villages that were just insane. They're like, yeah, I've spent a lot of money on it. I'm like, okay. Actually, fun story. The University of Texas at Dallas has a really strange mascot called T-Mock, and everyone makes fun of it because he looks weird.
It's Comet spelled backwards.
Yeah, and he, I don't know if I can say this, so edit it out.
I think we have before, but yeah, go ahead.
But people jokingly call him the Flaming Sperm.
Yep.
Because that's what he looks like. Where this is actually going is, at one point I was playing Clash of Clans in, I think, our major's building, and T-Mock the Comet wanders along, points at my phone, and does like a "what's this" motion with his hands. And I kind of look at him and go, "It's Clash of Clans." He puts his hands on his hips and does like this glaring motion and shakes his head in a very cartoonish manner, and then waves his hand at me like flippantly and walks off. And I was like, oh my God, T-Mock the frickin' Comet was calling me uncool. That was like my low point of my life. And so I'm hoping that Clash Royale at least is a little more competitive. And I'm like, would T-Mock approve? Is this a T-Mock approved game?
That's how you should live your life. Yeah.
I mean, well, the thing is, I'm also one of those stragglers who is still playing Pokemon Go. And I know in the back of my mind, that is probably not a T-Mock approved game either by this point. Like at the beginning, it probably would be. And, you know, the ethereal T-Mock on my shoulders, just always sitting there shaking his head. It's my story. I hope you like it.
I love it.
I always thought he was like this mutant Smurf.
That would make sense, but he's also on fire. So is he on pain? If he's a Smurf, is he in pain all the time?
Yeah, I would say so.
That would actually make a lot of sense and be great representative for the student body. Did you also notice his eyes look like he's high all the time?
No.
They're kind of half closed.
I avoided him. I saw him coming, I'd go across the street.
I think he is a thing of beauty, because like the student body, especially in ATEC, we were just a whole bunch of very awkward individuals that everyone was like, wow.
Nerds,
really?
And neckbeards.
Yeah. I know, nerds and neckbeards. And everyone looks at T-Mock and goes, ooh, wow, really? And I just thought, that is a perfect representative.
It's our people. Yeah.
That is... and. Again, that's why I just felt so hurt that he would diss my Clash of Clans.
And finally, the mobile minute that I have for you guys real quick is Super Mario Run, speaking of games that nobody plays on mobile anymore. Actually, they came out with an update recently that was kind of cool. They added this new mode called Remix 10.
They finally made the game cool?
I always thought it was cool. It just didn't have staying power, and that was kind of the problem with it.
It didn't have my money. That was the problem.
But what Remix 10 does is basically it takes short little sections of stages that you'll be familiar with if you played the game like through, basically. And they put in like these like three coins, typically these like big shiny purple coins you're trying to collect. And as you go through, it's like you can finish most of these stages in like about 30 seconds or so, maybe a minute if it's one of like the tricky ghost stages. But it's just like these really quick little bursts of platforming, and you have to be kind of technical in order to get to the coins, but you're not required to get the coins to get through. They basically put you on this path of like you go through 10 of these little short stages, and then you get to go through another set of 10 and another set of 10. And it's kind of just like this ongoing thing. The thematic thing is you're trying to save Princess Daisy. So she's a new character they've added to the game, and you have to clear 30 worlds worth of this, which I forget. I want to say it's something like 4 or 5 sets of 10 equals a world. So by the time you've done this, you've played through quite a bit. But it's great. It's just like a little sit down for 5 minutes, play a little bit of Mario without having to worry too much about like queuing up, like which level do I want to play? What am I going for? Because they have like lots of, you know, play through the stage for the third time to get all the black coins instead of all the red coins or whatever the case might be. They even added a little thing. I think they're trying to sort of encourage like making Mario just like a little part of your phone experience. You can have a little button that will sort of play and pause your music player. So instead of just going with the in-game music, you can have their sound effects on top of your music. When you're doing that, actually Mario and all the other characters will be wearing headphones, which is kind of fun. And so you just kind of sit down and you're just sort of jamming out to your music and you sort of be as mindless or as engaged as you want to be. The more of the special coins that you collect, the more bonuses you get. So at the end of each of these sets of 10, you get to sort of like hit the special block to get stuff for your kingdom.
That's kind of interesting.
Which the kingdom builder thing is like a feature they had since the beginning.
Yeah.
But I didn't use it all that much because you like spend your coins on stuff and you have to like think about where you want to place it and stuff like that. So I never really bothered.
See, I was genuinely interested in that part. Mm-hmm. It's just, I didn't pay the 10 bucks, so I couldn't get that far.
Yeah. And so what they do with this now is whenever you go through these like little bonus stages at the end of a run, they have an option you can toggle that just says place in kingdom. And so what happens is as you've played through it, your kingdom is just totally filled with the random junk that you've collected. So it makes it much more lively without you having to sit down for an hour and think about, you know, kingdom planning, essentially. So I played through, you know, the 30 things. It took me, you know, a few weeks of just sort of like playing sporadically. Unlocked Daisy, pretty cool character because she has a double jump, so that's helpful. It's just, it was kind of a neat, fresh take on Super Mario Run, and it was something that I felt like I could keep coming back to because it's just like little short bursts of gameplay that doesn't require a lot of sort of setup and lead up time. So if you haven't tried Super Mario Run, I'm pretty sure you can play that mode for free. So maybe give that a shot. I think at the time they launched it, there was also a discount where you could basically buy the game for half price compared to what it used to be.
Oh, really?
So I'm not sure if that discount's still in effect, but you might check it out and see if it is. For $5, I'd say it's definitely worth a grab.
And now, this week's meaty topic of discussion.
All right, so as we alluded to at the beginning of the podcast, our topic today is our sort of Halloween tie-in is costume design. But we're talking about costuming for characters in games. So we're going to be talking probably a little bit about character design, but more in kind of an aesthetic sense than necessarily a... We might touch on the gameplay and that sort of thing. But one of the reasons we wanted to have Cara on is because she is an artiste.
Hi there.
Doc and I have also had some training in art as well, so I'm sure we can...
Yeah, I just have a degree in it.
That's unfortunate.
That's not saying much. I got like 5 of those. So.
She's worked on different comics that she has written and drawn, I believe. And also you helped out with my master's thesis as part of your undergraduate capstone, doing the art for the game that I was writing.
Awesome stuff.
So you had a little bit of character design experience there.
Yeah, and some various card games and other sort of miscellaneous things.
Oh, yeah, Megalomania is one.
Yeah, and although I didn't do the direct design on those guys, I helped kind of influence where they would go in terms of direction. One of them was actually based off of a professor of ours.
Oh, nice.
And that was one of the things I helped pitched in the meeting. Mm-hmm. But also just drawing how the characters are portrayed on the actual cards, too, was something that was fun that I did.
Awesome.
That's called being the art director or concept director. Just make up a title.
Yeah, I wouldn't tell that to the game designers, though.
So I guess the question that I would have to maybe kick us off is, when you're coming up with the look for a character, what sort of considerations are you taking? Is it
good question?
Because I imagine that a big part of it is sort of being able to tell something about them at a glance.
Yes. So that's two of the main things. So first, you kind of want to think about the character's background, what their motivations are, where they might have come from, and that kind of helps determine the things they carry. And you also want to think about, what sort of tone do you want to portray to the viewers themselves? What kind of shapes will make up the character that, and you kind of have to sometimes go off stereotypes or cultural influences that might make viewers think differently about the character. So for instance, if you take, in Team Fortress 2, the Heavy, you look at him and immediately go, okay, this is just a wall of a man. There's going to be a lot of brute force coming after me versus the scout, who is this thin, gangly thing who can go really fast. So being able to just have players recognize them at a glance.
Sort of a form follows function.
Yes,
sort of thing. Yeah,
exactly. And then on top of that, you layer things like the Heavy had that kind of bandito sash that made him look more militaristic. The scout's little baseball cap kind of alluded to the fact that he may have been more of an American. Was he from Brooklyn?
Boston.
Boston. And just little accents like that help tell the story of who these characters are. And the tricky thing with the project that we worked on, we actually came up with the character stories and designs at the same time. And we were sort of layering things on top of each other, both in terms of narrative and character, and we helped build these things up together. But I think we had started with the core idea that there was like a clash between two towns. And then how do we differentiate characters between one town or another? You know, do we make one town look a little more rough versus people from the other looking a little more orderly? And how do we subtly do it so that we don't have to outright tell the players, this town is full of a ragtag team of people, or these people are uptight and crazy. So you have to kind of hint at things in order to make people understand where these people are coming from. And that's the majority of what you think of when designing new things.
That's super cool. Again, I will speak out of my ignorance here. Whenever you are throwing an idea to the team, I'm speaking in terms of teams here, it's not like there's just one person who's going to do all the costume design.
No.
Where does that fall in terms of the person who's actually putting that together and making those decisions? I mean, is there somebody who's drawing it first and then someone else is modeling it? Or how does that end up coming together?
So when I've worked on teams, in any kind of design process, you kind of either put together an art board or a variety of sketches. And you guys all discuss, you know, what is the tone we're really looking for? And how do all of these different pieces and research that we've gathered fit in to the message we want to portray? I imagine it's the same way with narrative. And then you take the little pieces, start to refine them into different sketches, and then take feedback and critique on, okay, this feels a little more like what we're trying to go for, or no, this is just completely off key. You know, we go back to the drawing board and figure out something else. So that's how it tends to be in more collaborative processes.
Right.
And the more research you do in advance and depth you can bring to the table, and even experience in terms of just either looking at different cultures or different cultural phenomenon, helps because you can also defend, you know, this is the line of thought here, and here's how I think that this might go if we approach this new direction.
Nice. One of my very favorite things about teaching game design at a master's level, at a graduate level, was being able to have different projects come at me. So the master's projects themselves and the PhD projects and things like that. And paralleling that to, say, the capstone project, which is the undergraduate version of that, lots and lots and lots of different things would come sort of by me that I literally just knew nothing about and yet could still judge, if you will, judge the merits of and say, hey, take it in this direction, go this way. And one of my favorite projects of all was the type of I'm going to design characters. I'm going to, and it's exactly what you're describing. Basically, it was a visual kind of an element. And there was some, call it a card, you know, sort of a 3x5 card of this is who that character is. But I was less interested in that, more interested in the art and having this little pantheon of characters. So I'm very interested in hearing you talk more about this idea of, let's say you have character A, and as defined by character A is character B, and then D through Z,
yeah,
through double Z alpha, right? You know, how does creating a cast of characters then change?
So when Chris and I actually did it, and we had a very collaborative process, we kind of took them into groups. You know, which characters do we want similar and having similar attributes, and which ones do we want to be clearly and distinctly different? And we focused on shape, color, things that they might carry, and tried to group them together. There was one in particular, we had a family. So we kind of, and they were actually a kind of outcast family from one of the towns, and we dressed them in similar garb, made sure their features, because we were actually creating different races of people, made sure their facial features all looked similar enough that you could tell that they were kind of from the same group. And, similar with the other town, we made sure that their colors all, while not being exactly the same, followed a similar palette. And then there was one guy that we wanted to make sure that he was visually an outcast. So we took a color for him that was just way off base. He got a lot of frills and flourishes that just didn't look like they quite fit in with the rest, but still had the same artistic style. So he didn't look out of character in terms of like the art direction, but he had different patterns about him. He wore his hair differently. There was another character who a lot of people had kind of straight, elaborate kind of knotted hair, and we wanted her to seem like she was more transient. So we put her, like, she actually had dreadlocks and beads all in it, which was kind of visually different. So we established first the characters and who they all were on basically like the 3x5 note card, and then developed the art around that depending on where we wanted them to both be and go in terms of their plots and establishing their backgrounds. Because what you're really doing is you're creating people. It's a character is not just a two-dimensional thing. It's you have to think about their past, present, and future and how they fit into this bigger puzzle, which is, you know, when you're designing groups.
That's the heart of the question right there.
That's
great.
That's the group. And you have to figure out how they all kind of complement or clash against each other. And there, I mean, there's lots of artistic ways you can do that, as I mentioned with color and shape.
Where do you draw the line then between archetype and stereotype? Or is that even the right question?
I let Chris kind of handle that. Well, the thing is, you also want to, in your research phase, when you look up different references and influences, you want to make sure you're not straight up copying, because other people go, well, I could have sworn that I saw this character in a Disney movie. And
well, sometimes they do that on purpose. Every Disney movie that's ever existed has an analog copy.
Yes. Well, and
it comes out 3 months before.
Once you're famous enough to basically have a trademark on like your character design, you can do that. Or we weren't necessarily going for that. We wanted to make something that looked a little different, although I got a lot of feedback of, wow, your style looks a lot like Avatar The Last Airbender, which was a major influence in actually kind of our project, but we weren't going for a carbon copy. But that's where you start falling into tropes, but you also want to start adding little things that are different and in distinguishing. Because I think we talked about tropes when we were developing characters for our capstone. Like, okay, you've got a village matriarch. How can we make her different? You know, what direction do we want her story to go in that she's not just like magical tribal elder?
Yeah, right.
And
it was a fine line
helps in the creative process. Fine line to kind of balance there, but part of what helps with that is when you work with a team, you get different input and someone to kind of hold you back and go, wait a second, this is literally Mario you're describing. Like, this is no different than Mario. What are you doing here? And that getting different viewpoints and perspectives always helps too.
Just as a quick aside, you know, mentioning the thing, like, this character looks just like this other character. I've been co-hosting a podcast where we talk about anime.
Oh, my God.
And so we have a couple people on the show who are very seasoned weeaboos. And we're kind of self-aware about it. It's fun. They'll be talking about, like, I'll say, like, oh, yeah, this character looks kind of interesting. It's like, oh, that's exactly the same character from yada yada show that I've never seen. It's funny, like, I'll be sort of interested in an idea, and then I'll just hear the rant from the other person in the room about how, like, oh, it's just like this, except this one was better, and all this different stuff. And
so when Puella Magi Madoka Magica came out.
Awesome show.
Which, it is my favorite show of all time, and I'm actually wearing a subtle Madoka Magica shirt right now, referencing the witches, because, you know, Halloween, witches. When it first came out, I looked at the characters and the color palette, and the only way I could tell just at a glance that it was different than Tokyo Mew Mew was because they didn't have a green character. Because, you know, you have a, you know, purple character, a yellow character, a blue character. And although I love Madoka Magica and I love the costume design, anime tends to have the same face syndrome and same body type. Now, they did change the girls up a little bit. You had different heights, you had different boob sizes, and you had different eyes, but the face shapes in anime tend to be the same. Hairstyles across one show might vary, but you have, like, once you have a collection of shows, there's a lot of ones that can be the same. Like, I've seen Madoka's haircut on so many different characters, and even Mommy's with the curls. Like, Mommy's curls always remind me of the girl from Catherine, that video game. And
there's also a few characters from Fire Emblem that remind me of too.
The kind of, what are they? The kind of like cues. Curly fry hair.
Yeah.
Curly fry hair.
Like bugles, like those.
Yes.
Those chips.
And that and the Sailor Moon hair. I think that probably was original at the beginning, but that with, and is it Hatsune Miku has her hair, Sailor Moon hair? Like, I try to make conscious decisions to try to do different things, unless I'm specifically trying to harken back to another character. Right. But, I mean, part of the problem is there's so much media now out there, especially with the creation of the internet, that you can't always avoid doing something the same.
Yeah, and that kind of brings us into the topic of originality, because you hear writers all the time, for instance, who are very concerned about, like, not wanting to just knock something off, or being kind of upset when they find out that, like, this idea they thought that was completely original, someone comes along and says, like, oh, this is just like this other thing. And they just didn't know about it until they were pretty much done working on it.
Right.
And I think that, you know, kind of the counter to that is, like, yes, to be aware of things and to not purposely try to rip things off. You're going to steal something. And, you know, we've all heard the phrase, you know, good artists borrow, great artists steal. But, you know, you have to steal smart. You have to steal the right things and not just all of it.
Tim Schafer, 2009.
Success. I think the most important thing is if you have a core message that you're trying to tell in anything, whether or not it's a character design or narrative, the plot may loosely sound the same, but if, as long as you're able to put your own spin, your own touch, and your own message on it, you're hopefully bound to put in something new and different in terms of perspective.
Exactly.
Well said. Yeah. I think actually that's a great answer to my last question, which was, where do you draw that line between archetype and stereotype?
And that's the answer.
Hope.
Your characters have to be true to themselves. They have to be true to the story you're trying to tell.
Right.
And so I think that, like, if you come up with a design that, even if it does look exactly like something else that someone else did.
Well, hopefully not exactly.
But even say it does, if you can justify it because, like, this character, this is the way they would do this because of X, Y, and Z, then it is what it is.
Well, not to harp too much on Stranger Things, if we haven't already, but Hop is my favorite character. He's amazing as the chief of police. And what our first image of him is drunk on the couch and late for work. And then he gets up and he puts on his suit and we realize that he's is a cop. Whoa, not a, and then he gets in his car and we realize he's the chief. And like, what? And so we went from one stereotype to another stereotype to another stereotype. And now by the time he gets to work and he says, mornings are for coffee and contemplation flow, we realize that we're going with the cop who's bad at his job, who likes donuts and is a drunk. So that's our stereotype that we're going with, or our archetype, if you like. And yet he evolves as a character more than anybody else over the course of the 8 episodes. Mm-hmm. We realize that he had a daughter who died and it plays in, and yet he saves the day and all this wonderful, wonderful stuff that comes out of that. And I've actually said on this show before that the most powerful moment for him is whenever we have the flashback to his daughter, and it does not happen until the final episode. We get a hint of it from another character. What happens is they're looking for buyers in the forest, and he says something about his daughter, and then the school teacher says, oh, well, will she be in my class? And someone else comes up to him and says, she died. That's it. That's all we hear for like 8 hours. And then the final thing, we're reminded of it, and we get the flashback in the most powerful moment where it matters so that we don't have to remember 8 hours ago. And all of that, I think, plays into the importance of the storytelling of this and that. But there are powerful images in just in the costuming, which I've never even thought of until you're literally sitting here talking about this, which is that without saying a word, he puts on this emblem of his office, this badge of his office, literally, but by suiting up and becoming cop man. Mm-hmm. And that takes us to a place. And I think it's the same with any kind of a character who has, let's call it an outfit. We can talk about like how superheroes have their superhero costume, but archetypes all have their costumes, mm-hmm. all of them. You bring in a fireman, we're going to react differently than the cop, depending on how you feel about those different characters versus the schoolgirl versus the classic Japanese schoolgirl. You know what I'm saying? The Catholic schoolgirl. Those are all similar, but they're not.
But
the
I've
same.
Heard that even people day to day, we put on and wear our costumes. Like women talk about it with makeup all the time.
Oh,
like
how, great example.
How are we going to put on our makeup to portray how we're going to be? Like I'm not wearing makeup right now because we are on a podcast and I realize that there's not going to be a camera, but you know, do I want to wear sharp looking eyeliner today? What's the message that I want to portray? You know, if depending on situations, do you wear something bright with a lot of color, you know, and what does that signal to other people? Mm-hmm. Women think about it too. Like, am I dressing too promiscuously? Am I being too casual? What Sure. signals am I putting out? And that also helps a lot with character design. Like, what kind of pajamas might this character wear? You know, when Hopper is on the couch, you know, is it a beat up white shirt that he has on before putting on the cop outfit?
No, like, it's clear he fell asleep in his clothes yeah. the night before.
So, you know, how the costumes we wear every day is how we want society to perceive us versus how we actually perceive ourselves too. Mm-hmm. Like, I tend to dress down a lot, but if I wanted society to perceive me differently, I would have to think about actively, you know, how would I have to change myself to fit a certain perception? Mm-hmm. And you have to layer that onto the characters too, with multiple levels. But
that's wonderful. That's a great insight, I think.
And, you know, kind of going back a little bit to when we were designing characters for Pilgrims, we were trying to come up with like a new mythology because it was supposed to be this story we were telling that was kind of myth-like, but we didn't want to draw on a specific culture. We were influenced by different cultures. And I think maybe one of the reasons, interestingly, that people said they reminded them of Avatar, one, just kind of like the style of your drawing kind of reminds that.
Yo, oh, yeah.
But also, I would think that because we kind of had a... sort of like pseudo Middle Eastern influence in our
designs.
And
African.
Yeah.
We had kind of a desert environment, and similar in the way that Avatar pulled on from Chinese, mm-hmm. Japanese, Thai, Vietnamese cultures.
Inuit also.
Inuit for the water tribes, mm-hmm. and Tibetan for the monks. We did something similar to pull from, like, we had this weird combination between Native American, African, and Middle Eastern, mm-hmm. that we kind of hodgepodged together in a way that created something new.
Mm-hmm. Which is what some people define creativity as, is basically just combining a bunch of different things into something new.
Yes, and without making it too obvious where we pulled it from. Mm-hmm. Like, I think we started out, when I was talking earlier about doing research, I had built 4 different mood boards of where we wanted to go. We mm-hmm. had a very northern, snowy, both Scandinavian and Inuit board. Mm-hmm. We had that kind of desert Middle Eastern African board, a jungle, more Aztec, which we kind of seemed to determine right off the bat that that may fall too close to trope territory, like mm-hmm. with Indiana Jones mm-hmm. sort of style, and sci-fi, which we also thought it's been done so many times that it'd be really hard for us to forge new ground and new territory with. So we actually combined the Inuit, Native, Scandinavian board with the desert mm-hmm. board. So taking 2 combinations and mash them together to make something that looked a little bit odd. I liked it. I like how it came out, but mm-hmm. it, and then from that kind of basis, we determined, you know, who are the people that we want to create? What are the stories we want to create? And then layered all of that research kind of on top of it.
Mm-hmm. And so I think that too, like, you know, once we sort of determined our general look and feel, for example, in the village that's at the foot of the mountain, they're very religious, they're very spiritual. And so we wanted to communicate for those people who were in kind of the religious class.
It was also very homogenous.
Yeah, very
homogenous. So we wanted people mm-hmm. to look very similar, both in the way they dressed mm-hmm. and in ethnicity. We yep. had those 2 different towns. One was more homogenous and one was more hodgepodge.
Because mm-hmm. it was a trading post, basically.
Trading post.
Yeah.
So we had people, different hair colors, different eye colors, different kind of tones to mm-hmm. their skin. And the homogenous town was very, I mean, it was the same.
Mm-hmm.
And so when your character wanders into there, your character, the protagonist, looks right off the bat as very other.
Mm-hmm. Although we did intentionally keep some similarities between the player characters, they're actually closer to this homogenous mountain group. Yeah, in garb. Because they were actually kind of an offshoot of that same culture from however many generations back,
mm-hmm.
Which is kind of interesting too. But we, for example, the matriarch gave her these like sort of flowing, almost
imposing robes.
Yeah, and you did a good job of making them kind of have a look that was, it kind of evokes religion, but not a specific religion. You know, in the same way that, you know, kind of to your point earlier, Doc, about how we can sort of take visual cues from icons, you
right.
know, visual things have sort of a meaning to us the same way that language does, where we can see something and kind of like it evokes in our own head other things that we're familiar with, so that it kind of communicates instantly an idea that's, you know, at least in the same territory that we want them to get eventually, as opposed to this person's wearing a t-shirt and jeans that says something totally different than the flowing robes.
You're making fun of me?
Yes.
Yes. But like, because in at least Western culture, big flowing robes, you see them on monks, you see them on priests, you see them on, you know, images of prophets.
Mm, that's right.
Judges.
Judges. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that does signal a layer of judgment, mysticism, and preaching.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Derivative's not always bad.
Yeah. So, but they were odd robes. Like we put a bunch of designs and they were this bright blue.
Mm-hmm.
So the religion we crafted, had this symbolic flower that was this bright blue that we implemented on a lot of different things. And it's not a color that you often associate with religious figures, which is how we kind of added something new. Like we, something old, something nude, something borrow, and something blue in a very literal sense.
Congratulations.
But it is taking something that is recognizable and adding different layers onto it to tell your own twist and your own story.
Yeah, that makes sense. A lot of times we can build a character around just an icon, just a symbol of that person.
Like Hopper's badge.
Right. Or I would think of like the Pirates of the Caribbean, you know, he had that...
Oh, I love that movie. I love that series. Other than
it's great, isn't it?
There's so many 4 and 5.
Strong characters in it.
Elizabeth's evolution, both in the way she carried herself, what she wore, and how she acted. And the most disappointing thing, I did not see the 5th movie, but I saw the clip at the end where she appears, and she is back in that kind of English... feminine garb with the necklace, and her hair's done up, and it just destroyed my vision of this character, the one who wanted to break out of that. And all of the symbolism throughout all the movies, like she, especially when she was wearing the more Asian garb as the Pirate King, she tossed aside her culture, her everything she was raised with, to become this badass that, I mean, that was so counter to what was expected from women of the day. And she reverted to that at the very end because they, you know, they got Keira Knightley last minute and went, oh my God, how do we fit her back into this? But it just didn't make sense to me from the standpoint of the character. Like, she should have probably been on the open seas raiding and pillaging by that point.
Yeah, no kidding.
And also, so that kind of ties into, what do you do with characters after you've built them up? You know,
kill them off every time.
I was almost expecting they would do something like that, but instead there was disappointment. They did. They killed her character. That is whatever that wasn't Elizabeth.
They canned it up. I mean, that's what they did. And then they let her out of the can, and it wasn't what you expected.
It's all a clever ploy on her part, though. She's infiltrating society to pull off the ultimate heist.
Well, that's kind of what I wondered. That was my immediate reaction was, oh, what was she pulling?
Well, and she didn't seem like, well, there was a lot of what was she pulling in the later movies, but it didn't seem like she had an overarching and scheming goal like Jack Sparrow did. But from the standpoint of, let's just talk about the first movie for a second and characters. If you look at just the silhouettes of the governor, Elizabeth's father, Elizabeth, Norrington, Blacksmith Will, and Jack Sparrow, just take that cast and just look at them, you get a solid idea of who they are and their backgrounds immediately. Yep. Norrington is this well put together, beautifully uniformed British officer. The governor with his over the top hairstyle, clearly he is someone who comes from wealth. Like, dear God. Elizabeth, I mean, there is always with women in media and, you know, women who are trying to break away from bounds of society, there's a corset scene, the huge hips, the feminine hair and expectations, and then Will, who is dressed like a peasant. Like, you get a beautiful idea, both in shape and tone and color and patterns of their costumes, who the heck they are, and they don't even have to open their mouths. It's and then they open their mouths, and it gets even better, and it just builds up.
You know that scene where Jack sails in as his boat is sinking?
Oh, that is an icon.
Okay, so the other day I'm actually playing The Witcher, and I'm in a boat, and sailed up to when you're on the island and you're supposed to go meet Yennefer for the first time on the island, and I sailed the long way around and just happened to just crash. Well, not on purpose. This was totally an accident. I'd actually just been out there diving for treasure and stuff. And so I sailed back into the port, and as it happened, it triggered the cutscene. And it's the cutscene where, they're having the funeral, the Viking funeral, right? But you can't see it because my sunken ship is in the way.
Oh, my God.
It was hilarious. It was so – because, I mean, I literally came in, hit the dock, and it sunk. And I'm up. I mean, I had to swim to shore.
This is why we can't have nice things as gamers.
It was perfect, though. It was just. It was one of those things.
And designers can't anticipate when players do garbage like that.
I know, right? So yeah, it was hilarious and fun. And it was the second time I'd played it through, so it was okay. But yeah, it was a lot of fun, that particular recreation of that moment. But anyway.
So as a way to kind of wind this episode down, I was thinking maybe we could all talk a little bit about games that we think do costume design really well in a way that kind of communicates the characters. And Cara, you already mentioned Team Fortress 2.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God.
Really great cast of, like, the silhouetting. Good example. I've talked about a lot before.
Oh, yeah. Like, and from a distance, you can tell what is coming at you just by shape alone.
So it true.
Because they had to assimilate an entire team based off color. Mm-hmm. So you had to have something else that differentiates the characters. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And they did it beautifully.
Overwatch follows in that tradition pretty nicely.
Oh, yeah.
You mean Team Fortress 3?
Yes. Yes. And what's actually kind of cool about it is that you sometimes get characters that could be confused for one another. Like, for example, you've got, this is one random example that comes to mind, Widowmaker and Ana. Both are snipers.
Yes.
But Widowmaker has this very upright posture. Ana has this more stooped posture. And so the posture is also another thing that they kind of took advantage of. And of course, there are other differences in costume. Ana has like this cloak and stuff like that that differentiates her. So they have multiple things that differentiate these two snipers. But sometimes the posing and the expression and all that sort of stuff is just as important to that sort of silhouetting and letting the player tell at a glance who's who.
And they brought in nationality too, mm-hmm. like which... In a lot of media, I tend to see things are homogenized, mm-hmm. or you have the token different character.
Right, yeah.
And a lot of people are different in that game.
Or that racially ambiguous character that could be anything from, like, Native American all the way up to black.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which... Pilgrims, actually.
But Overwatch, they've actually talked about how they are very intentionally trying to be inclusive with their cast. So they go out of their way to make sure they have a lot of different cultures. Even, like, you know, for example, the character of Orisa, who's just this robot. Also interesting in terms of silhouette because it's almost like a centaur sort of... you know, her designer is this young African girl. And so you see her in some artwork. You don't see her in the game necessarily, but like they're trying to hit all the continents because this is supposed to be our...
A worldwide thing.
Yeah, our relatively near future. So we've globalized by now. Like everyone's kind of more or less on the same level except for Australia because Australia turned into Mad Max. But
I mean, it's not already.
Good point.
It's Australian.
Shout out to our Australian fans.
Yay!
Woohoo!
But, and I would argue that I know a lot of people would be like, we don't want to have all of this forced diversity in our games, you liberals, you know, all that bitching. But I feel like with Overwatch, because it's done with the tone of national, like international cooperation, it doesn't feel as forced as having like a token different character would.
For sure.
Whereas we just shoehorn Smurfette in there because, you know, we needed a woman versus everyone is, you know, coming from a different source.
That was critical to the original plot of the Smurf movie.
Yeah. Which is unfortunate.
Yeah, which I'm talking about the 80s, the 70s or 80s, whenever that came out, Smurf movie.
Gargamel made her.
Yeah, he made her.
Yeah, totally. No, it still felt very forced, dude. Okay,
well, that's fine. You know, if you don't want inclusion.
And now we're arguing about Smurfs.
I know, right? Well, we did do T-Mox, so.
Yeah. Well, and still character design there, you know.
Terrible character design. You know, you can
still distinguish all the Smurfs from each other. And, I mean, didn't actually Smurfette have black hair and then turn blonde when she was good, too? Like, that's still a character signaling there.
Yeah, that's true. I think that's more to do with the Smurfling, whatever her name was. I forgot. Because there was a second female Smurf. She came along later.
So something interesting, too, that speaking of casts, Final Fantasy 15, if you look at the main set of four characters, your main party, they have a very sort of similar design. And it's not like super colorful. It's all like they're
black,
wearing black and gray. And
yeah.
But like, you know, I think one of the characters adds a little bit of splash of color. So that tells you a little something about him.
Mm-hmm.
And the types of clothes they wear, the way they wear their clothes, tells you a little bit more about the characters too. And again, going back to the silhouette, the posing and the shape of the characters, you get four very distinct people, despite the fact that they're all wearing black and have spiky hair,
mm-hmm.
which is interesting. It's like, you know, you've got like the muscly tattooed Gladio who, like, you know, was wearing this open vest. You've got Noctis who is kind of like, you know, princely, but also very casual. Mm-hmm. You know, he's kind of laid back. You've got Prompto who is very energetic and like his clothes are all like, I think he has like one long pant, one short pant. I'm forgetting exactly, but
is he the one with tails? I think he had one of them had tails.
He might have had like something coming off of his belt or something like that. Okay. I forget. And then Ignis has like, you know, the nice suit and the glasses, and he always has really good posture, and he's very well kept. And so just at a glance, you kind of get a little something of their personality too, just looking at that lineup.
That's true. Yeah. Fallout, the original Fallout 1, because whenever you actually put on clothes, your character model changed. And that was one of the very first games that did that. Now, there were other games in that same series that, you know, the isometric kind of thing. Baldur's Gate did it and that kind of a thing. But this idea of actually finding a purple monk's robe from the Children of Adam and then putting it on, seeing your character change, and then being able to walk around among them. And if you got caught, you still had to enter into a dialogue of, what are you doing here? But they didn't immediately start attacking you. That was game changing for me. That was a paradigm shift for me of, oh my goodness, the clothes really do matter here. Mm-hmm. And I have to decide whether or not I'm going to walk into this town being a scary looking guy who, I mean, he looks like a raider, but he's well protected. Or do I want to walk in with civilized clothes and have a better conversation? And it was meaningful. That's my answer.
I was actually disappointed because I thought you would get something similar with Red Dead Redemption. Mm-hmm. Like they say, oh, if you're wearing this, this gang won't attack you. I have never actually used any of the alternate costumes in that way.
Really?
Yeah. I didn't feel like I'm also bad enough that everything would end up as a gunfight anyway. So, or if I just avoided the right areas, people wouldn't attack me anyway.
Yeah.
And they all kind of felt so similar, except I really liked the Legend of the West. So I got the Legend of the West costume. I put in the time to get that one specific outfit. That the outfits actually didn't matter as much as I thought it would, and it kind of hurt my experience.
Oh, that's
with
a shame.
Red
Dead. Yeah.
Did you guys actually use the different outfits there?
Yes and no. I think I honestly found something that I liked that was very me. And that kind of thing. I have never been one for changing clothes before going into a bartering session. I just don't.
Yeah.
It's not worth it.
And I feel like they put a little too much stock in that. And like with the Fable games, I would find one outfit that I really like. It usually was the female bandit outfit or something that I was just like, dang, I feel like hot stuff, you know, and just proceed with that for the rest of the game, no matter what. It was a ride or die and whatever.
Yeah.
Same thing with Skyrim, you know.
Good example.
If you got cool armor that was more or higher level than, you know, what you wanted to wear, I would still wear it. I had the crazy, you know, that it's not wildling, but the wildling type tribes. Mm-hmm. I had the crazy woven hair throughout the game instead of helmets because I just thought that was neat.
That is neat.
And I had that with the Nightingale armor, which was really strange looking, but that was my ride or die outfit because that's how I perceived my character and wanted to go forward in those games.
Which is disappointing.
Yeah.
One of the few, I guess, utility based costuming games that I've used for its intended purpose, Zelda, Breath of the Wild.
I've heard the outfits are awesome.
They're awesome.
I keep looking.
And I've actually really enjoyed it, and especially with the new DLC and stuff. I mean, there's some masks that are wonderful for their utility, being able to find the little Koroks and things like that. And so in that sense, yeah, I've used that for what it's intended to be because it actually helps. Oh, I'm going into a hot area. I better switch over into this clothes or that clothes. Or, ooh, that guy looks scary. I better put my armor on.
Actually, with the other Zelda games, because the only other Zelda game I have played from beginning to end, just because I didn't have a lot of consoles growing up, was Twilight Princess. Mm-hmm. And I would also swap costumes to either swim or, you know, put on them iron boots. And I mean, I think the Zelda series has done a really good job of doing the utility costume swap over other games.
And I think it's because you don't have clothes that have stats. You have iconic useful clothing that you collect along the way. And so it feels more like a tool and less like, oh yeah, this is my collection of hats that will help me with my personality. And this is my collection of hats that will help me with my, what, you know, whatever.
Well, yeah, like the random stat boosts. And
yeah,
stuff like
no.
I'm going to put this on to get bargain better or find a lover in the case of the Amulet of Mara in Skyrim.
There you go.
You know, if only it was that easy, you know. I'm DTF, puts on a necklace.
That's totally how I met my wife, so.
Oh, well, I guess your experience is different.
So thank you everyone for joining us for our 2017 annual Halloween Spooktacular. Our discussion on costume design, among other things, and our scary long button Mosh and Mobile Minute. And Cara, thank you for joining us once again.
Thank you for having me.
To remind everyone, we are trying to grow the show, so anything you can do to help us with that would be much appreciated. Share us with your friends, tell people about the show, like, comment, subscribe, et cetera, you know the deal. And also, we'd like you to get involved. Feel free to email us at inbox@backward-compatible.com if you have any questions, topic ideas, just if you want to respond to something we've said on the show, or maybe tell us about something that we didn't mention that we totally should have, you idiots. And of course, we've got our ongoing segments, Jim Bag and Woke Jim. So Jim was not with us here today, but he is with us in spirit.
Spooky.
Anyway, I'm Chris.
I'm Doc.
I'm Cara.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show, because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox@backward-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.